Good afternoon. My name is Frank Leebeek. I'm a hematologist at the Erasmus University Medical Center. And today I'd like to talk to you about gene therapy for hemophilia, the cure for the royal disease. And we have done the research that I'm going to present also within the ACE, hemostasis and thrombosis. So hemophilia A is a bleeding disorder, the most severe bleeding disorder that we know, which is caused by a deficiency of factor VIII in case of hemophilia A and factor IX in case of hemophilia B. The prevalence of hemophilia is about 1 in 10,000. That means that in the Netherlands we have about 1,800 patients with hemophilia, mainly males because it's an X-linked disease and is caused by mutations or gene deletions of the factor VIII or factor IX gene. The hemophilia A is much more common than hemophilia B, in about 6-to-1 ratio. The severity of hemophilia can be characterized by severe, moderate, or mild symptoms, and therefore it's also divided into these categories. If you have less than 1% or no factor VIII or factor IX in the blood, we talk about severe hemophilia. Moderate severe hemophilia if you have between 1 and 5%, and if you have between 5 and 40%, we call it mild hemophilia. And why is it called the royal disease? It's the royal disease because Queen Victoria was one of the most famous carriers of hemophilia, and she had a grandson, Alexei, as is shown on this picture, and he was the son of the Russian Tsar, and suffered from severe hemophilia B, as it turned out later. So why do you have a bleeding tendency when you have factor VIII or factor IX deficiency? Here is a schematic representation of the coagulation system in which it's shown that at the time of injury or surgery, when an injury is induced, tissue factor will become exposed and will activate factor VII, and that will lead to a cascade of coagulation factors that are activated. Finally, thrombin is formed, and by thrombin formation also a loop comes into action, as is shown here. You can see here that once this thrombin is formed, you can see that factor XI is activated, and that activates also factor IX and using its cofactor factor VIII. And due to this thrombin burst, more fibrin is formed, and fibrin is the most important part of a clot. And if you don't have enough fibrin, a clot will degrade very soon and a patient starts to bleed. So what kind of bleedings are seen in hemophilia? Mainly joint bleeding and muscle bleeding. Also, intracerebral bleeding may occur, and in some patients also, if they are not treated properly, they can bleed after interventions like surgery or dental extractions. Important thing to remember is if you have severe hemophilia, you will have spontaneous bleeds, and that may add up to 40 to 60 bleeds per year. Whereas if you have moderate or mild hemophilia, you only have bleeds after, for instance, trauma or interventions. So having a small amount of factor VIII or factor IX is already enough to stop those spontaneous bleeds. Here you can see a schematic representation. If you have no factor VIII in the blood, as is depicted here on the x-axis, you'll have a lot of bleeds, for instance, joint bleeds. And if you have only a slightly increased level of factor VIII or factor IX, the number of bleeds will be reduced. And if you have, let's say, 15 to 20% of factor VIII or factor IX, then the risk of bleeding is strongly diminished. So, and here are some examples of bleeds that may occur in patients with hemophilia. For instance, you can see here in the arm a bleed in one of the muscles, and also a calf bleed here. Due to the fact that these patients, once they start bleeding, bleeding will not stop. And here you see a young boy with a joint bleed in his right knee, which is very painful and leads to eventually also to hemophilia arthropathy. So long-term damage due to the recurrent bleeds in joints and muscles. This is an old picture. This is a recent picture of a boy from Pakistan, in which in many countries that are maybe have less resources, these patients are not treated properly, and still you see these types of bleeds and arthropathy occur. And that has to do with the fact that the treatment of hemophilia is very expensive. So what is the current treatment? Of course we treat patients if they have a bleeding episode. For instance, if you encounter such a bleeding in the muscles or in the joints, patients get treated with factor concentrate, the level is normalized and the bleeding will stop. But you actually also want to prevent patients from bleeding, and that's what we call prophylaxis. So we treat them with factor concentrates, let's say 2 or 4 times a week, intravenously, and by administrating factor concentrate, you see the concentration of factor 8 and 9 go up, and this will lead to a lesser bleeding phenotype. And once the level becomes around 1 again, 1%, you give the next dose, and this is actually how patients have been treated over the last 50 years. So there are drawbacks of this treatment. First of all, you need regular intravenous infusions, which is harmful for the patient, of course, and burdensome. Bleeding still occurs. There's a fear of bleeding, no cure of the disease. Several complications can occur due to the fact that you infuse factor, and it's very costly. And therefore, as I mentioned, many patients in the world are still not treated. So, what is the aim of gene therapy in hemophilia? Actually, what we would like to do is to insert a wild type factor 8 or factor 9 gene in a patient with hemophilia, for instance by AAV-based gene therapy, and to make sure that the factor 8 and factor 9 gene will be expressed and the protein will be measured in the circulation of these patients. This will lead to a reduction of bleeding and also in the long term of arthropathy, and eventually leads to a better quality of life without the necessity of those regular infusions of factor 8 or factor 9. Here you see a schematic representation how we can apply gene therapy in patients with hemophilia but also with other inherited disorders. Now there are actually 2 ways of doing gene therapy: direct delivery or cell-based delivery. Cell-based delivery, we use hematopoietic stem cells, which are taken out of the body of the patient. They are in the laboratory genetically modified by, for instance, adding a certain gene or gene editing. And these modified cells with the normal factor 8 or factor 9 gene, or in case of thalassemia, of the globin genes, can be infused again into the patient and will make the normal protein to be synthesized. So that is one way. This is not the case in hemophilia. In the hemophilia, so far, we have mainly used the AAV factor approach, a direct approach in which we use an adeno-associated virus, which is crippled, has no potency to make the patient sick. But what it does, it brings the gene of interest, in this case a factor 8 or factor 9 gene, via the intravenous way into the liver, because you use a hepatotropic adeno-associated virus. It will get into the nucleus of the hepatocyte, remains episomally located because it's hardly integrated into the human genome, and by that AAV application it will lead to factor 8 and factor 9 expression. And here you can see, so we have, for instance, the DNA encoding for factor 9. The virus contains this factor 9 gene. It is brought via intravenous way into the human cell, in this case the hepatocyte, and that will lead to factor 9 protein expression. A very simple approach, and actually it has taken many, many years for this to be successful. I think the first hemophilia trials have been performed already more than 20 to 30 years ago, and this was actually the first study done in the UK showing the effect of AAV-based gene therapy for hemophilia. In this case it was hemophilia B, an AAV8 factor was used. And what is shown here, and I just take one picture from this article, is that there was an expression or a factor 9 measured between 5 and 9% of normal. So leading to a milder bleeding phenotype, these patients did not need any factor anymore and did not have any bleeding complications. So what about our research in this field? Now, we have collaborated with several companies that have developed these AAV viruses. And actually, we're one of the first in the Netherlands to give the gene therapy for hemophilia B to patients that suffered from severe bleeding phenotype. And we were able to give the gene therapy using an AAV5 capsid, which was depicted here, and we encoded a liver-specific promoter and a human wild-type factor 9, and this was done in the expression cassette and eventually led to production of factor 9 in these patients with severe hemophilia B. How was this done? The AMT-060, that was the product that we used, was intravenously administered after it was prepared in the pharmacy. It took only 30 minutes to get this infusion done. The patient, for safety reasons, was taken in, was hospitalized for 24 hours. Nowadays, we actually dismiss the patients within 3 hours. We treated in this phase one trial 10 patients, and of those, three were treated in the Erasmus MC. And what are the results now? So these are two cohorts, low dose, high dose cohorts. Actually, what I would like to show you here on this picture is that there was a stable expression of factor 9 between, let's say, 2 and 10%, also for the higher dose, a little bit higher expression, which lasted at least, now we know, at least 4 to 5 years. So after once given gene therapy, these patients did not need any factor anymore. So instead of treating themselves 2 to 3 times a week intravenously, they now did not need any treatment after this gene therapy. So very successful, leading to a better quality of life. But 5% is still not a lot. I told you that if you have 5%, you still have mild hemophilia. Can't we improve this by giving, for instance, more factor? No, that is not possible because then you get too much side effects. But what we can do, and this is what was done in a second study that we performed, was using a mutant that has been described earlier in Padua, which was seen in a family who had a thrombotic disorder because of the high factor 9 levels. And that was due to the fact that their factor 9 was more active than normal factor 9. So if you use the DNA, or the mutation that was found in those patients in your gene construct for gene therapy, you will end up with higher activity levels. So we thought we go from 5 to, let's say, 30 to 40%. And that was shown recently. The data have just been presented at a meeting and will be published soon. 54 patients who received this gene therapy construct had increased factor 9 levels without having the need of getting factor 8, factor 9 concentrate. And you see that these levels are between 25 and even higher, to up to 80%, but mean levels, or mean levels, are between 39 and after 1.5 years, still 37%. So this actually leads to a near normal factor 9 level, no bleeding complications anymore. So this is, for these patients, a very good treatment. What about hemophilia A? Because that's more common, as I explained. Those patients also are in need of gene therapy. The problem with this gene therapy is that if you have an AAV vector, it has only a limited capacity of including factor 8 or factor 9 gene. Factor 9 gene is very much smaller than the factor 8 gene, so it took some time to get the factor 8 gene into this AAV vector, but finally it was succeeded. And what you can see here, and this is a recent study published this year, that in this phase 3 study, the patients had levels much higher than seen in factor 9, up to 200% in some of these individuals, but a median of about 30 to 40% also. And the only disappointment was that after a year, and also after 2 years, you see a decline of the factor VIII level. So instead of factor IX that stays stable for 5 to 8 years now, we see the decrease of factor VIII levels. And in the phase one study, we have seen already in a limited number of patients that these levels go to 2 to 5%. Also in these patients, sometimes liver function abnormalities are seen, which are hardly seen in the gene therapy for hemophilia B. So have we treated also patients with hemophilia A with gene therapy? Also in the Netherlands, we treated in another study based on the AAV vector. We treated one patient at the end of 2019. Actually, it was the first patient with hemophilia A treated with gene therapy in the Netherlands. He had a very high factor VIII expression, above 100%, no bleeding anymore, even 2.5 years after the treatment. But also what we saw in this study was a decline over time. So this patient didn't need any factor concentrate, had no bleeding episodes, but unfortunately had prolonged ALT elevations for which he needed treatment with corticosteroids. And we do not know exactly why these patients have these liver function abnormalities, but that will be sorted out, I hope, in the future. This is a busy slide, but I'd like to show you what the current status is of hemophilia gene therapy treatment. The benefits are clear. A single infusion in these individuals leads to factor expression even up to in the normal range. So these patients, from being treated 3 times a week intravenously, now to go to a once in a lifetime infusion. But there is a problem, and I'll show that later on. The durability of this response is limited for the hemophilia A patients. For hemophilia B, we don't know whether it decreases over time. It's still stable in those patients who have been treated 8 years ago. Reduction of bleeding episodes, no need for prophylaxis, and improvement in the health-related quality of life. That's the upside. But the downside is that there's a high variability in the levels that are achieved in those patients. We do not know exactly why that is. The immune response to the capsid may lead to temporary liver function abnormalities and lead also, if you don't treat that appropriately, to a decrease of levels. Also, patients with AAV antibodies that are present before gene therapy cannot be treated, of course, with these AAV-based gene therapy, so that limits the applicability of this gene therapy. Probably also high costs will be if it becomes available, there will be high costs associated with gene therapy. And the long-term durability, as I mentioned before, is a concern, especially for the factor VIII patients, the hemophilia A patients. So if we go to the future, what about the Erasmus MC? What can we do? I think if we look at hemophilia A or B as a model for gene therapy, then we can see that it's feasible, it's safe and effective. The hematopoietic stem cell-based gene therapy is available for other diseases already. For instance, for thalassemia, sickle cell disease, and also companies have developed it, studies have come out, so we are, of course, wanting to start that treatment also for our patients in our department. Development of gene therapy is also available now for ongoing in other disciplines, like for instance in metabolic diseases, neurological disorders. So it's important to collaborate. And also, if you do fundamental research on gene therapy or gene editing, as is now performed in many departments, like in the pediatric department, in the hematology department, on these diseases, then it's very important to make this a combined effort within the Erasmus MC. And I think that we, as Erasmus MC, should invest in a clinical gene therapy center, support fundamental research, support translational research, and support clinical research in order to help our patients and to improve their outcome and quality of life. Thank you for your attendance.